So the main purpose of this seminar, of this presentation, is trying to share with you how you can use cell depths with the Cadmium simulation tool. So first of all, well, this is the table of contents. First, I would like to do a very, very brief introduction to cell depths. Then I would move on to how cell depths is implemented in Cadmium. And finally, I would like to share with you a very simple use case with real code, and so we are all able to see how everything is done. First of all, well, cell depths is a combination, as most of you may know, between cellular automata and the DEVS formalism. So the idea is we're going to simulate cellular automata, but with a lot of different properties that make them better, like a better performance, etc. So cellular automata scenarios are commonly something like this. So somehow we are simulating a space. We are giving to our simulation a spatial concept, and each element of the scenario is called a cell and represent a portion of the space. And each portion of the space, each cell, has its own state. And its state changes with time, depending on itself and its neighbor's cell. Like, for example, that's why we are always talking about neighborhoods, etc., because that is how we define our neighborhood. This is a very typical neighborhood, the von Neumann neighborhood. It's myself and north, south, east, and west. No, you have a lot of different neighborhood, like Moore is very common too, extended von Neumann or extended Moore, etc. So, well, I started working with this cellular automata stuff, with these cell depths within the sustain project. We wanted to integrate beam models with cellular automata, with cell depths, and trying, for example, to simulate how people move around the campus or something like that. However, suddenly, the COVID pandemic came. Everything went crazy, and I had to leave Canada, etc., to go back to Spain. And we said, okay, why don't we keep using this tool, but why don't we focus our tool to, for example, exploring how a pandemic is spread around the space? So that is what we did. We started to read some state of the art, etc. We did very simple models with our previous tool, the CD++ cell dev simulator. And reading more papers, we found something like this. We found that someone called Thong and its collaborators did something related to cellular automata in which cells were not squares and they were not evenly distributed. They didn't have anything like von Neumann neighborhoods or Moore neighborhoods, because they went a step farther. They say, okay, a cell is going to be a region in a map, and the neighborhood is going to be defined by some properties that they share, like, for example, the length of the border that they share, the connections between roads. For example, this cell here has a road that is connected to this other cell. So even though these cells are not colliding, they are not together, they are somehow neighbors, because it is very easy to move from this cell to another one. So the state of this cell may affect on this other one. And we really liked this idea, and we wanted to somehow redefine the cell depth formalism, making it a little bit more broad, a little bit broader, so we could also have something like this. And we said, okay, let's implement the cell depth formalism in our new tool, Cadmium, and let's try to make it possible to do this kind of scenarios. So, okay, this is a little bit of a nomenclature that it is not fixed, because it's something that we are working on this, but more or less for everyone to know, in cell devs, we're going to have a set of cells, and each cell, CA sub I, is going to have its own state. In this case, I said theta sub I. For example, in pandemic models, we can say that the state of a cell can contain the population of the cell, how many people is infected, how many people has diseased, maybe the ratio of people of one gender or another, or age segments, whatever. But this is going to define the state of the cell. And this state is only known by the cell itself, and no other cell can access to this state. Then a cell has also a neighborhood cell. And every cell that is in this neighborhood is called a neighbor cell, a neighboring cell of our cell. In this case, is a CH2Y. Okay, so for example, if the cell CH2Y has a neighborhood cell like this one, and then our cell is going to have a copy of the state of these neighboring cells, which is like zeta j with this weird symbol. Note that this is not the state of the cell j, it's a copy of it. This is important because it is not also, it is not either the current state, it's the latest state that we know about this cell. And well, finally, we also decided to make directed neighborhoods. So for example, in this new formalism, we can have a scenarios in which the CH sub J is a neighbor of CH sub I, but not the opposite. CH sub I is not a neighborhood or a neighbor of CH sub J. We added a new characteristic of the cell desk formalism, which is the vicinity. Okay, we know that CA sub J is a neighbor of CA sub I, but why? Which is this relation that makes them being neighbors? This is the vicinity. It could define, for example, the connectivity between cells, how many people goes from one cell to another one in a daily basis, whatever you want to define to your model that characterizes how cells are interconnected, how the neighborhoods are defined. You could use, for example, von Neumann neighborhoods, and the vicinity would be, it belongs to the von Neumann neighborhood. But you can also extend this idea to richer neighborhoods definition. Again, the vicinity between one cell and the other one can be different if both are neighborhood of the other one. Let me see, like for example, the vicinity from cell Y, from cell I to cell J could be completely different to how cell J considers, say, cell I. It's a little bit confusing, but well, more or less, this is the idea. Imagine, for example, if this is a common example here in Spain, we are very, very, we are now in the TV, we are always talking about the elections in United States because the president of the United States is very important for us somehow in the economic field or whatever. But I'm sure that it is not the same the other way around. Like who is the president of Spain is not as important to American people as the American president for us. And well, we may also want to provide some additional configuration parameters that could affect how the state of our cell changes. This is the C sub I set, the configuration parameters. These are only known by the cell. It affects how the state changes, but it is not part of the state. For example, I have here some examples like the virulence of the virus in a pandemic. It will affect on the number of people that gets infected, but it is not part of the state. The state is how many people are infected, not how often people get infected. This is more or less the idea. And again, the configuration parameters of one cell can be completely different to another cell. We can have, I don't know, in very sunny countries, the virulence is less because, I don't know, the virus spreads better when you have cold or or warm or warm weathers. I don't know. So you can have different virulence depending on the cell that you are looking at. Okay, how do we work with this? We have the following. We just have to worry about the local computation function and the delay function. Whenever a neighbor, cell sends us a new copy of its state, one of these, no, like the one with the weird symbol, then the cell triggers its local computation function, its tau. And the tau is going to provide us the new state of the cell. This zeta, I don't know the name in English, like the new state, okay? And it's a function of its current state, the latest public state of our neighbors, the vicinity between our cell and their neighbors, and the configuration parameters. And this is something we have to somehow describe. Also, when the state changes, for example, we have in the previous state, no one is infected. But because of the particularities of the rest of the parameters, the new state contains, I don't know, 1% of people infected of the virus. Then the state changed, and we have to communicate to our influenced cells that we changed our state. We send a copy of this new state to our influenced cells, those cells that considers us as a neighbor, but we are going to send this copy after waiting a given delay. It was something that we call delayed output. My state has changed, but I'm going to wait, I don't know, for example, 1 day or 1 second, depending on the model, this delay would be different. Again, the delay function has one input parameter, which is the new state. So we can define different delays to different states. And we only have to worry about the tau and the delay function. That's all. We, as you may know, the DEVS formalism contains a lot of different things like external transition functions, internal transition functions. We don't have to worry about it. Cell DEVS is going to do it for us. So let's see how Cadmium implements this. This is a UML diagram, a simple one, in which, well, we can see that the scenario is a coupled model with the following template parameters. We have time. We don't have to worry about it. It's how Cadmium is going to represent time. The cell ID, how are we going to label each cell? Like every cell has its own ID and it's unique. It could be, for example, a string. It could be a number. We are not going to worry about it now. We also have to say, okay, which data structure are we using to define the cell state? This is this red S. And also, which data structure are we using to define the vicinity between cells? This green V, okay? And well, regarding the cell, a cell has the following parameters. Its unique ID, a vector containing the IDs of those cells that define its neighborhood, the configuration parameters here in blue. These are optional because maybe you don't really want it to your model if it's very simple, but you can define them. And then you have the state. The state is composed of the following: the current state of the type S, the neighbor's state. This is the copy of the latest copy of your neighbor cells, which is an unordered map, which you have as key the cell ID, and as value their latest copy of the state. And also you have this neighbor's vicinity, which is an unordered map with the cell ID of their neighbor cells as keys, and the vicinity that define this neighborhood as value. This is a little bit the idea. And then, as I told you before, you have to worry about implementing the local computation function that must return a new state, and the output delay function that returns how much time you have to wait before publishing your new state, which is an input parameter of the function. As I told you, we are going to wait, I don't know, imagine that we are going to wait 5 seconds before we publish and we communicate to our influenced cells our new state. So how are we going to wait this time? All the cells implement one delay buffer that is in charge of this. It's in charge of managing waiting for the correct amount of time before sending messages, etc. In fact, you have three different delays. You have the transport delay buffer, the inertial delay buffer, and something in the middle, which is the hybrid delay buffer. Okay, so regarding these delay buffers, which delay buffer do you have to use? It depends on your model and on the scenario that you want to explore. You have to know the following. The transport delay buffer is going to produce, is going to send an output message per every cell state change. So if your cell changes its state 5 times, you are going to have 5 output messages. The inertial delay works a little bit different. It only delays the latest state change. Imagine that your state changes and you have to wait these 5 seconds before sending this change. Okay, maybe before reaching these 5 seconds, your state changes again. With the inertial delay buffer, you just preempt the previous state change and only schedule the latest state. So somehow the number of output messages is going to be less or equal to the number of state changes. And the hybrid one it behaves as the transport delay. Okay, it is going to produce one output message per every cell state change. But we are introducing some new logic to ensure that the latest message is going to be the latest state change. So here I have an example, okay? Imagine our cell is changing its states from 0 to 1, 2, 3, 4, and 1 again, okay? And we've defined a delay function that says, okay, you have to wait the same amount of time as the state before publishing this state. So for example, if your state is 1, you're going to wait 1 second. If it's 2, 2 seconds, etc. With the transport delay, as I told you, you're going to have one output message per each state cell change. So here you change to 1. Then you wait 1 second and send an output message to your influenced cells telling, hey, my state is 1. Here your state is 2. So you wait 2 seconds, 1, 2, and you send this message. You can see that, for example, the hybrid delay and the inertial delay behaves exactly the same. But here, we start to experience some differences. Okay, our state now is 3. We have to wait 3 seconds before sending this new state to our neighboring cells. 1, 2, 3, hold on. We have changed our state before publishing the previous state change. For the transport delay and the hybrid delay, it doesn't matter. You say, okay, I have to wait still 1 more second and publish the 3rd state. And now I have to wait 4 seconds and publish this 4th state, okay? And they do that. They wait 1 more second and publish the previous kind of outdated state to the neighboring cells. However, the inertial delay says, okay, so I have to publish a new message, a new state, but I have something in the queue. Well, let's throw it. We are not going to send the previous message and we are going to wait until, okay, we are going to wait in this case 4 seconds and we are only going to publish this 4th state change. So, okay, let's wait 4 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 8. here again. So, oh, sorry, 1, 2, A. But the state changed again. Now the new state is 1. So we have to publish this 1 instead of this 4. The inertial delay says, okay, now I'm going to throw the 4 state. I'm not going to tell my neighboring cells that my state was 4. And I'm going to wait 1 second and just publish the last state, in this case, 1. Sorry, one moment, because the TV somehow, okay, sorry. What happens with the transport delay? As I told you, the transport delay is going to produce 1 output per state change. So here, I'm going to wait 4 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 4. Here you are, these 4. However, before, we changed our state to 1. And the transport delay said, okay, don't worry, I'm going to wait 1 second, I'm going to communicate this 1. 1. As you can see, in the transport delay, somehow, there's kind of a glitch, a very strange behavior in which our neighboring cells will think that the latest state is 4. But our real state is 1. And that's how, working with different models, I found this issue and I defined the hybrid delay, which is, okay, behave exactly as the transport delay, but if this happens and you have this state message sweep, just throw previous message, outdated message. So you get this 1 and you ignore the previous state change. That is the idea. Again, which delay buffer you have to use? It depends on your use case. Normally the transport delay or the initial delay are okay. But if you're going to define very complex delay functions that will potentially have these behaviors, okay, then consider changing your transport delay buffer to a hybrid delay buffer or using the initial delay buffer. Everything is okay. Let's focus on a use case. How can we use the Cadmium simulation tool? I'm going to talk about the pandemic, a very simple pandemic model. I'm very used to it. I've been working with these models for a while. So I'm going to present a SIRT model, susceptible, infected, recover, and diseased model. So this is the following idea. Our population in our cell is going to be divided into the susceptible people, people that can get infected, infected people, people that are already infected, recovered people, people that were infected but they are not recovered and they are immune to the disease, and diseased people, people that unfortunately died due to the disease. So how do we change between states? There are some probabilities, factors that makes us, for example, moving from susceptible to infected. This is called the virulence we're going to say it. Don't worry about it. So first of all, normally the idea is, okay, I'm going to do a SIRT model or whatever model I want to do. I recommend everyone to illustrate it using a mathematical model. Like the first step, we are going to say, okay, let's try to make this this example a set of mathematical equations. So first of all, how many people is going to get infected at time t? Well, we have here a very, very big formula that tells us as much we can get infected the total susceptible population in the previous time step. So it's like if we have 3 people that is susceptible, we cannot have 4 new people infected. That's not possible. But well, let's figure it out, the ratio of susceptible people that may get infected. And I say, okay, is something related to our neighbor cells? And it depends on how cells are connected, how people move between my cell and the neighboring cell. This virulence of the pandemic, maybe it is very easy to get infected. Maybe it is very difficult. This depends on the disease. And also the number of people that is infected. So if there is no one infected in my neighbor cell, in my neighboring cell, then no one is going to get infected. So you have to take this into account again. How many people is going to get recovered? Well, you have this recovery factor multiplied by the number of people that were infected in the previous time, in the previous time step. The number of people that died, more or less the same. You have the fatality rate that tells you the portion of infected people that died because of the disease. And finally, we're going to say, okay, the number of susceptible people is the number of susceptible people in the previous time step minus the new infections. The number of infections is the number of infections in the previous step plus the new infections minus the new recoveries minus the new diseases. And this is just summing the corresponding factor. This is the idea. So, okay, now we have this mathematical model that defines what we want to simulate. Second step, let's classify everything. Let's try to say, okay, what part of the equation is the state of the cell? What part of the equation tells us things regarding the vicinity between the neighboring cells? And which parts are configuration parameters? So in red, you have state variables. The current state of the cell that is computing, for example, the new number of infected people, no? So you have the susceptible people is part of the state. The population is part of the state. The number of infected people is part of the state. Again, the number of recovered people or the number of dead people is part of the current state. If you look at this equation, I have this dark red stuff. This is related to the state of our neighbor cells, our neighboring cells. I used a different color because, as I told you, this is not the current state of the neighboring cells, but the latest copy that we know at the date when we start computing the new number of infected people. Then this recovery rate, this fatality rate, this virulence rate, affects to the new state of the cell, but it doesn't have nothing to do with the state of the cells, with the number of susceptible people or infected people, but how the disease behaves. So that's why I'm going to say, okay, I'm going to put this as part of the configuration parameters that will affect the behavior of the cell. It's not part of the state. I don't want to share to my neighborhood, to my neighbor cells, hey, my virulence is 0.6. I don't want to share this with my neighbors. It's going to be something private, and therefore it's going to be in the configuration part. And finally, as I told you, how a neighboring cell affects us depends on the connectivity. We can define the connectivity, for example, the number of roads that connects us, the number of, the buses, or whatever, no? It's something that defines why my neighboring cell is a neighbor of myself, okay? And then we have the mobility factor, which is like how many people goes from my cell to my neighboring cell, okay? If no one moves from one cell to another one, even though you have a lot of roads and a lot of buses, I don't know, it's a very unpopular neighborhood, then this mobility factor is going to be zero. And therefore, the number of infected people in this very unpopular neighborhood, in this very unpopular cell, is not going to affect us. So if there is a lot of people infected in this cell, I don't care because no one goes there, and therefore, it's not going to affect to my state. This is a little bit the idea, okay? We have the configuration parameters, the vicinity parameters, and the state parameters that we need in our model. So let's try to code it in Cadmium. Let's go to Cadmium. Okay, I'm going to show you some very simple examples that you can find here in this repository. Simulation Everywhere Models, Cadmium Cell Depth Tutorial, okay? You have different models, there are 8 models, and they are incremental. I mean, this one is a very simple susceptible infected recovered model. Then we make some changes and we create the second model. Then we create, we made some changes. Okay, that's the idea. I'm preparing a tutorial in a document, and I'm going to use this as a reference to somehow show how to enrich your models. Okay, but we're going to focus on these models, the spatial susceptible infected recovered disease model and the agent seared model. The difference between the spatial model and the agent model is that this one represents this lattice of cells, okay? You have like, I don't know, like 50 by 50 cells, and you have von Neumann neighborhoods, this kind of classic cellular automata approach. And the agent version is going to have, okay, I have this region that is connected to this other one because they share the border or whatever, okay? That's the difference. But they are really the same, okay? Here I have in the C. Lion IDE this same project, the Cadmium Cell DEVS tutorial repository, okay? I have everything kind of prepared. So one thing you have to do after cloning this this project, of course, you have to have Cadmium installed, etc. Okay, I'm assuming that you already have it. If you don't, there are a lot of manuals to doing this. So let me see. Okay, let's try to do it manually. We are using the CMake tool. Okay. Because you know, I defined everything with this cmakelist.txt file. So to use it, I say, okay, let's go to. I'm going to say, okay. So I have the build directory. I say cmake the previous directory. Everything is done because I made sure that everything is going to work. And you can see that now we have a lot of stuff here, and we have a make file. So let's make, and it starts making everything, all the executables, okay? It is going to create four executables in this case. And all the executables are going to be in the bin folder. So it is working, but you're going to have the executables here. So let's try to focus on how it is implemented. So as I told you, I'm going to focus now in the seared model. This is a very common directory structure that you're going to follow using the Cadmium Cell DEVS tool. You're going to have a main file that will contain kind of the top model. You're going to have a configuration file that is going to say how the scenario is defined. And then you're going to have a model folder. In the model folder, you're going to have a file to define the state data structure, a file to define the vicinity data structure, a file to define the coupled model, and in the cells directory, you can have more than one cell that you're going to use in your model. In this case, that is very simple. We're going to use just one cell type. So first of all, how do we define the state of the cell? Let's see. As I told you, a cell state has the following fields: the number of people that lives in our cell, the ratio of people that is susceptible to the pandemic, how many people is infected, the ratio of people that is infected, the ratio of people that is recovered from this disease, and how many people died due to the disease. Okay, and you just have to define a structure like this with all the different parameters that you want to use in your model. Okay. What else you have to do? This is not all, okay? You just have to define the data structure that is going to define the cell state, and you also have to do some additional steps. First of all, you have to tell Cadmium how to tell if two different states are different. As I told you, the local computation function is going to produce kind of the new state of the cell, and then the cell is going to say, okay, is this new state different from the previous state? Because if they are different, I have to communicate to my neighboring cells that the state changed. That is why you have to define this operator, okay? To tell Cadmium how to tell the difference between two different states, the previous and the new. you have also to tell Cadmium how to print the state. So in the log files, we can access to the different, you know, the different parameters, and we can know the population of the cell, how many people are susceptible, etc. And also, you have to tell Cadmium how to read a JSON file that describes a state structure and fill the parameters of this state structure. Now I'm saying, okay, if you find a label that is called population, then the content is the number of people that lives, the susceptible people, infected, recovered. Okay, that is the idea. And you have to do everything, you have to do all these steps for a lot of different chunks of the code. For example, we have also to define the vicinity. We have to define how we describe how neighboring cells are connected. And if we go back here, you can see, let me see, that we have this connectivity factor and this mobility factor. So our vicinity structure must have a connectivity factor and a mobility factor. Again, we have to tell Cadmium how to read a JSON file and fill the gaps, okay? And say, okay, the connectivity is going to be the connectivity field. The mobility is going to be the mobility field, etc. Now that we have the state and the vicinity defined, we're going to create our first cell. Okay, this is our cell, this is our Cadmium cell model. You can see that it inherits from a grid cell because we are using these grid scenarios, these like 50 by 50 scenarios, etc. This is a grid cell. And you have to tell which structure is going to describe the state of the cell, the shared structure, and which structure is going to describe the vicinity between cells, this mobility connectivity structure. And also you have this cell config, which is of the type shared cell config. Let's go. What is the shared cell config? It's here in the same file, okay? I'm going to describe the structure that we use to set some configuration parameters. The shared cell configuration has a virulence factor, a recovery factor, and a fatality factor. If we go here, we have the virulence factor, the recovery factor, and the fatality factor here, okay? And again, you have to tell Cadmium how to read a JSON file and fill all the attributes, okay? So that's mainly all. There's a lot of stuff, but I don't want to focus on it. I'm just going to go to the local computation function. As I told you, you have to worry about defining a local computation function and a delay function. So the local computation function is going to return a certain structure, this new state. We compute the number of new infections, the number of new recoveries, the new diseases, and we just say, okay, the number of new diseases is going to be the previous number of diseases plus the new diseases. The number of recovered people is going to be the previous number of recovered people plus the new recoveries, etc. Okay, as in the equations, it's exactly the same. I do a little trick here. We just want to have two decimals, okay? So we round the outcome, but that's all, okay? That's why you have these round formulas, etc. But we are doing exactly the mathematical equations. We are not doing other thing. For example, if we go to the new infections function, which was this very long equation, we can go there. And well, if you go line by line in your free time, you can see that we are just following this equation. We are doing this sum here at the beginning. We are doing here this sum. And then I'm going to return the minimum number between the number of susceptible people and the susceptible people multiplied by the virulence, etc. So I'm just doing this, okay? So that is why it's a very good practice to first define a mathematical model and then try to translate it to C++ code, okay? Okay, we have this search cell, and then we have to do the following trick. All the cells are going to be in a coupled cell DEVS model, which is cadmium cell DEVS, grid coupled in this case, because they are grid cells, lattice-based cells. Again, you have to say which data structure defines a state, which data structure defines a vicinity between cells using this template oriented programming. And then you have to just add this method, override this method, add grid cell JSON. Somehow, okay, cadmium cell DEVS doesn't know which cell models you are going to use. So you have to tell him, you have to tell Cadmium which cell models are possible to use in our model. So for example, I say, okay, the cell type, I only have one cell type, which is the shared cell model, because I only have one cell. If I had more, I would have like, else if cell type is, for example, shared, like susceptible effective recovery disease, susceptible again, then you have to load another model, but we only have the shared model. So you have to, here you have, to load the shared cell. You use this template-based programming. If you go to shared cell, let me see. Where am I? Okay. I have here like the this Zoom stuff here, and I cannot click the properly. Well, the idea is the shared cell is the cell that I just showed you. This class. And I also forgot about the output delay function. You have to define an output delay function. In our example, it's very simple. You just say, okay, just wait one simulation tick. That's all, okay? So we have this. We compiled everything here. So let's go. And we want to simulate a very simple scenario to see some outcomes. So we have to provide a configuration file, a JSON configuration file. In this JSON configuration file, you say our scenario is a 50 by 50 cell DEVS scenario. We have 50 by 50 cells. We're going to use wrapped scenarios. This wrapped scenarios is, for example, if you are in an edge of the scenario, let me move here because maybe visually it's easier. If I'm here on an edge of the scenario, then my north neighbor is going to be this one, no? Because it's wrapped. The scenario is wrapped somehow. The north neighbor is this one. If we are not using wrapped scenarios, my north neighbor doesn't exist. That is the difference. You can select both stuff here. You just say false or true. You select the different scenarios. And also we're going to say, okay, cells. We are going to define different cell configurations. We have to define a default cell configuration. This is very important. The default cell configuration is going to be the configuration of every cell unless you tell something different. So I'm saying by default, all my cells are going to be of type shared because it's the only one that I have. They're going to implement the inertial delay buffer. I can use, for example, transport or whatever. You can change this here. I'm going to stick with inertial. And the default state is going to be 100 people in our cell and everyone is susceptible. No one is infected, no one recovered, no one has diseased, okay? The configuration is going to be the following by default. The virulence of the disease is going to be 60%, the recovery factor is going to be 40%, and the fatality factor is going to be 1%. And the neighborhood is going to be a von Neumann neighborhood. The one like this, okay? This is the neighborhood that we are going to explore, the von Neumann. And I'm going to say that all all the cells that are in the von Neumann neighborhood are going to have a connectivity factor of 1 and a mobility factor of 0.5. But I'm also going to specify something interesting because maybe you've noticed that you are part of your neighborhood. So You have the north, the south, the east, and the west cells, but you are also a neighbor of yourself. So I'm going to say, okay, let me override some values. So for me, the 0, 0, this is a relative position. The 0, 0 relative cell is myself. The 0, 1 is going to be the south. The south, no, the 0, 0 is here. The 0, 1 is going to be the south cell, okay? So myself, I'm going to have a connectivity as one of one, as all the other cells, but I'm going also to have a mobility factor of one, because everyone moves from myself to myself. So I'm going to do this little trick, okay? This is the default cell. I'm going to shrink this, but I'm also going to define other cell initial configuration, other cell initial state. This epicenter cell is going to inherit all the parameters of the default cell, everything, unless you override something. In this case, I'm just overriding the state, and I'm saying, okay, epicenter cells are going to have 30% people infected and 70% people susceptible. I'm not telling, for example, the delay. Then it's going to say, okay, the default cell, what has? What does the default cell has? Inertial delay, okay, so the epicenter cell is going to have this inertial delay. Which is the default cell type? Sheared, okay, so the epicenter cell is going to have the sheared type again. Unless you tell something different, everything is inherited from the default cell. That's why the default cell is very, very important. Okay, we have this, and then we have to define our cell map. By default, as I told you, all the cells of this 50 by 50 scenario are of the default cell configuration. But you can say, hey, we have a bunch of epicenter cells. For example, the 24, 24, and I'm going to add another epicenter cell. I'm going to say, okay, the 10, 10 cell is also an epicenter cell. So all the cells in our scenario are going to be the default cell, and these two cells are going to be the epicenter cells. Now that we have this, let's go to the binary folder, this one here, where all are all our executables. And let's run our model, which is this one. Remember the 1, 3 spatial susceptible infected recovered diseased model. So I'm going to say, sorry, here, just 1, 3. And then I have to tell Cadmium the path to this configuration file, this JSON file. So you don't need to recompile the code every time you change your configuration, your scenario description. You just have to provide Cadmium this JSON file that describes the whole scenario. So for doing so, I'm going to do the following. The configuration file is here. I'm here now in binary folder, and I have to go one step up to the 1, 3 spatial shared folder, and here is my configuration file, the config.json file. So let's do it. This is going to take a while. It is simulating all the scenario that we've defined here, and eventually it's going to provide us, okay, here it finished. So we may assume that everything went well. Let's see. In the logs folder, we are going to have the output of our models. Do you remember the model that we are simulating is this one, the 1, 3 spatial search output. So let's see what this file shows us. Oh, a lot of stuff, no? Ah, you can see like here, all the cells have this default state. 100 people, everyone is susceptible. Okay, let's dive a little bit here. Let's go to the 2424 cell, which is one of the epicenter cells. And here you are. The state of our epicenter cell corresponds to an epicenter cell. So let's find other message from 2424 we have here. The time advanced from 0 to 1, and you can say here that some people got infected, other people recovered, and other people died. It's the same for the 10-10, the other one. And if you see all these cells, IDs, okay, they are all this von Neumann, they correspond to the von Neumann neighborhood of our epicenter cells, no? Like the 9-10, the 10-11, you know, the 11-10, the 10-9. They are the von Neumann neighborhoods of our epicenter cells. And you can see that eventually this is a very long file. Eventually, everyone gets this state here. No, like very similar to this one. Like we have 1% people susceptible, 80% people susceptible, sorry, recovered, and 20% of people died due to the pandemic. I'm not going to show the visualization tools because otherwise it's going to take very long, but we have very nice visualization tools developed by Bruno or Kevin. For example, the tool of Kevin is able to make these nice curves. So you can see how many people are susceptible with time, infected people, recovered people. So even though this is very difficult to read, don't worry, you can use very nice visualization tools. This is taking too long, I'm sorry. Okay, we've done the spatial shirt. I'm going to be very fast with this, don't worry. Let's move to an agent shirt. This is exactly the same model, but we are using this approach, this one here, okay? We're going to use this approach. Instead of using these neighborhoods, we are going to have a regular neighborhoods, etc. This is the difference. So I'm not going to go through the to all the, for example, you can see like the state is exactly the same. It doesn't change. You have populations, susceptible people, infected, is everything the same. The vicinity is everything the same. We only have connectivity and mobility, and we still have that. The only difference, for example, in the shared cell is the following. We don't inherit from grid cell, but from cell. And as this is a cell, you have to tell Cadmium which data structure you are using to identify its cell. In my case, I use the strings. So for example, I could have one country that is Spain, another one that is Canada, etc. That is how I'm going to identify a unique cell. With grid cells, you don't have to do that because Cadmium already knows that how you are going to name these cells is the 00, the 01, these kind of tuples, okay? But if you use the agent-based one, you have to define, okay, I'm going to use strings. That is the only difference that you have to do, nothing else. What could be also different? The configuration file. We're not going to define, you know, this shape. There is no shape here. There is no wrapped scenarios here. That doesn't make sense here, okay? We are only going to have cells. Again, very important. We have to have a default cell. All the different cells are going to copy this default cell configuration and say, okay, my delay buffer is inertial, my cell type is shared, my state is this one, unless you tell something different, okay? You can see here that the default configuration is exactly the same as in the previous example, but we don't define a neighborhood because there is no von Neumann neighborhood, there's no Moore neighborhood. So I just leave empty the neighborhood, okay? By default, you don't have neighbors. And then I have to go cell by cell in our scenario and define, okay, I have, for example, one cell, which is country one. As I told you, no, for example, I'm using strings to identify each cell. So the cell which ID is country one has the following configuration parameters. And I'm going just to define the neighborhood of this cell. I'm going to inherit everything from the default cell, but I'm going to define the neighborhood of our country one cell. As I told you, no, myself is a neighborhood, sorry, is a neighbor, and its connectivity and mobility is one. Country two has very nice transport between country one and country two, and also a lot of people goes from one to another. Country three is very badly communicated, but I don't know, it's a very popular district, so everyone goes there. That is a little bit the idea, no? Country two, I'm going to override the state of country two. Country two is going to have 400 people instead of 100 people. And also 1% of the people of this country is infected. The other 99% is acceptable. I also define the neighborhood of this cell. I define, for example, country one, country two, and country three. You can see here that you can define very, very complex neighborhoods with this approach, but also somehow you have a very long file, okay? It's kind of this, you have to deal with it. Either you have very, very small number of cells or you have a very, very long JSON file, because I also have to define the country three. If I don't define the country three cell doesn't exist. And as you are saying that country three is part of my neighborhood, that means you're going to say, hey, you told me that there is a country three cell. I don't see it and it crashes, okay? So it takes a little bit more long. For example, country three is going to have 250 people instead of 100 as default, okay? That is the idea. And I'm going to, I see here that I know we have, okay, sorry. I'm going to simulate this scenario. We can do it from the console. Let's do it from the console. So as I told you, now we have you have to run the 2-3 agent search, okay? Two, three agent search. This is the executable that we are going to run. And I'm going to provide the location of the configuration file for this model. So it's not the 1-3, but the 2-3 config JSON. I'm going to provide, you know, the path to this file, the one that I just showed you. Let's simulate it. It is very, very, very fast. Why? We only have three cells. In a 50 by 50 scenario, we have 2,500 cells. So you can tell the difference in performance. Like, these scenarios are going to be very fast compared to the other ones. And again, we have here in the logs the results. This one, the 2-3 agent shared outputs. Let's see. It is a very, very short file because we only have three cells in this case. And we can see that at the beginning, the country one has the default state, country three has 250 people instead of 100 people, and the country two has 1% of people infected. Everything starts running depending on our equations. And at the end, we have the following. Let me see. Country one ends up having 20% of people dead, 77% of people recovered from the disease, etc. The country two has 12% of people dead, 52% of people recovered. You can tell somehow the difference between very populated cells and low populated cells. This is kind of a richer approach. And well, this is more or less everything I wanted to tell you. I'm sorry because I know I took very long. So if you have any question or you want to, I don't know, ask something, please go ahead.
So thank you, Roman. It was a very good presentation. So I'm going to stop the recording.